Good morning, everybody. My name is Pastor Pete. I have the privilege of serving First United Methodist Church in Brookings. Our theme for today reminds us that God is bigger than any particular building. In fact, God is even bigger than any particular faith tradition, because we will be reminded that it was wise men who came from the East who knew about Jesus and worshipped him. And so join me in our call to worship. I will prompt invite you to recognize that in bold print, and if you're brave enough, you can even say it aloud at home. Glory to God in the highest, and hope to every discouraged heart. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to every conflicted soul. Glory to God in the highest, and joy to every downcast spirit. Glory to God in the highest, and love to everyone. Let us sing praises to our God. Let us offer this light against the darkness. And so we sing our opening song. I'm grateful to our worship team for putting it all together. So welcome to our worship today. How was your Christmas? Did you get presents? You have food? I bet you're saying you had too much. I do want to thank all of you who sent me cards and sent greetings on social media. Some sent gifts. It's much appreciated. I also want to recognize my colleague, Jen Tyler. Recognize her because she welcomed us into her home over the last few days. While we have been able to be in touch with our family via social technology, it's wonderful to have a real flesh and blood person. And it's been great, Jen, to be in your home.
It's been great to have you.
And that explains why you're looking and wondering what church we're recording this in. We are in First United Methodist Church in Watertown. And Jen is the pastor of this church. And it's wonderful to be able to have this kind of colleagueship. And I felt it was only respectful and right, having been in Watertown, to allow the amazing Methodist pastor in Watertown to lead us in prayer. And so I'm going to hand over to Jen and invite us together to come before God in prayer.
Let's pray together. Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for your spirit that unites us even as we gather from so many different places. We give you thanks for the gift of fellowship, whether it is through our online worship, through social media that connects us over the miles, or through family, chosen and biological alike. We ask, O God, that in this time of worship, that you would come and fill those places that we find ourselves in, and that you would fill our lives anew with your Spirit as we seek to honor you with our time, with our prayers, with our presence, and with our gifts, this and every day. In the name of Christ Jesus, your newborn Son. Amen.
Amen. It is customary, Jen, that we share peace together. And within our church, because of social distancing, we would normally hug each other, but we haven't been doing that. So I will model. You guys can hug each other at home, but I'll model for us. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The peace of the Lord be with you, and also with you. Today is a special service because we have a team. Jen has been part of the team. There is another member of our team who is going to be preaching for us. I think it's only right that I recognize the privilege of having Steve Eliason to preach for us today. He is a certified lay minister in our church, has been in leadership in our church for many years. And I'm really grateful for Steve, who will read scripture, who will preach, and I'd ask that you'd hold Steve in your prayers as he does so. Before we do that, we are going to worship God together in song as we take a moment to prepare our hearts before God, and then we hand over to Steve.
All is calm and all is bright everywhere, but in your heart tonight they're singing carols of joy and peace, but you feel too far gone and too far out of reach.
Somewhere in your silent night, heaven hears a song your broken heart is crying. Hope is here, just lift your hand, for love has come to find you. Somewhere in your silent night.
Heaven's height to manger low, there is no distance the Prince of Peace won't go. From manger low to Calvary's hill, when your pain runs deep, your love runs deeper still. He has always loved you, child, and he always will.
Somewhere in your silent night, heaven knows a song your broken heart is crying. Hope is here, just lift your hand, for love has come. Find you. find you. Love will find you.
Our gospel reading is from Matthew 2, verses 13 through 23. When the Magi had departed, an angel from the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod will soon search for the child in order to kill him." Joseph got up and during the night took the child and his mother to Egypt. He stayed there until Herod died. This fulfilled what the Lord had spoken through the prophet, "I have called my son out of Egypt." When Herod knew the Magi had fooled him, he grew very angry. He sent soldiers to kill all the children in Bethlehem and in all the surrounding territory who were 2 years old and younger, according to the time that he had learned from the Magi. This fulfilled the word spoken through Jeremiah the prophet. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and much grieving, Rachel weeping for her children, and she did not want to be comforted because they were no more. After King Herod died, an angel from the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt. "Get up," the angel said, "and take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel. Those who were trying to kill the child are dead." Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus ruled over Judea in place of his father Herod, Joseph was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he went to the area of Galilee. He settled in a city called Nazareth so that what was spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called a Nazarene. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Our scripture reading today is about Joseph, Mary, and their baby fleeing from Bethlehem to Egypt. I first want to introduce myself and tell a little bit about myself and my family. I am Steve Elias and a lay leader here at First United Methodist Church. I also teach third grade Sunday school, and I am the leader of the United Methodist Men Group. I married my wife, Penny, right here in this very church in 1997. We have two children. Camden is 16 years old and Asher is 9. Have you ever had to flee, like in the scriptures today? I have never been told to flee, but I have moved around some. I grew up in Canton, South Dakota. After high school, I attended Augustana College, now Augustana University in Sioux Falls, and then on to South Dakota State here in Brookings. From there, I moved to Minneapolis, Minnesota for my first full-time job with Twin City Fan. And in 1994, I moved to the Brookings area due to a position in manufacturing for Twin City Fan. In a way, I did flee Minneapolis because I didn't like the traffic and I didn't like the crowds. My preference has always been the wide open country. I first arrived in Aurora, just east of Brookings. After marrying my wife, Penny, we moved into Brookings, this town of Brookings, and then a few years ago, we moved, along with our sons, Camden and Asher, a couple miles north of Brookings for a place in the country. Note that there are no crowds in the country, and it is wide open country. When I read this scripture, I couldn't help but think about the radio personality Paul Harvey, whose radio show entitled The Rest of the Story aired on ABC radio networks in the mid-afternoons on Mondays through Friday from 1976 to 2009. Paul Harvey's stories presented little-known or forgotten facts on a variety of subjects with some key element of the story, usually the name of the well-known person, held back until the very end. Well, you already know who the key element is in this story, so I'm not going to hold that back, but there are some little-known facts that were not included in the Bible story. I think we often focus on the Christmas story, on just the birth of Christ, and that's the end of the Christmas story. This last Advent season, we've heard about Mary, Joseph, shepherds, wise men from the East, and the light of Jesus. Let me provide a short recap on the Christmas story. Mary and Joseph had to travel from Nazareth to Bethlehem because Joseph was a descendant of David. And it was required to travel to their ancestral town to be counted for the census. Mary gave birth and named the baby boy Jesus while staying in a stable because there was no room in the inn for them to stay. Shepherds left their flocks to see the baby Jesus lying in a manger. Wise men followed a star that guided them. They talked to King Herod, who was king in the area, and Herod wanted to know when and where the king of the Jews was born. After the wise men found baby Jesus, they left him gifts and then returned home by another route. Manger scenes in the church and in their homes show Mary, Joseph, a baby lying in a manger, shepherds, wise men, and possibly an angel and some other characters along with a stable. So what happened next? What's the rest of the story? That's what was in the scripture reading today. An empty manger. Joseph in a dream was told to get up, flee to Egypt with the child and mother until he's told to return because King Herod will search for the child to kill him. Why was it so urgent for them to flee the area? The wise men had met with Herod prior to finding the baby and spilled the beans about the baby being king of the Jews. Herod was a Roman-appointed king in the Judean area. Based on the information from the wise men as to when the star first appeared in the sky, Herod decided to kill all the male children, 2 years and under. That was possibly a dozen children. This is known as the Massacre of the Innocents. The majority of Herod biographers hold the killing of the children to be a myth, legend, or folklore, possibly because this paled in significance compared to other evil acts he had done. From the Encyclopedia Britannica, I found that Herod, who was raised as a Jew, ruled over Judea for 32 years until 4 BC. He built massive fortresses and splendid cities. He built a great palace in the Judean desert, which archaeologists identified in 2007. His most grandiose endeavor was renovating the Second Temple in Jerusalem. There were too many construction projects to mention, along with him being president of the Olympic Games. There was a dark and cruel side to Herod. His mental instability was fed by intrigue and deception within his own family. He murdered his wife, her two sons, her brother, her grandfather, and her mother. He even killed his firstborn son. The slaying of the Bethlehem infants was consistent with the disarray into which he had fallen. Joseph was warned in a dream by an angel to get up and flee the area to Egypt so that his infant child would be spared from the cruel Herod. At most, I've traveled 220 miles to live from one location to the next, and I used a moving van. Joseph, Mary, and their child traveled about 600 miles with a donkey to their destination in Egypt. Their travel to Egypt was ironic because from the stories in Genesis at the time of Moses, the Hebrew people were slaves to the Egyptians. Now it was a sanctuary for Jesus and his parents. Note that Moses was spared from certain death as a Hebrew baby. Jesus was also saved from certain death by Herod. The Roman Empire had already built good roads for people to walk on near the Mediterranean Sea. That would have provided quick travel, but the Bible only tells us that they traveled to Egypt. Now, I'm going to provide the rest of the story based on tradition of the largest Christian church in Egypt, the Coptic Church, which was started by St. Mark. At that time, there were many Jewish communities in Egypt because 600 years prior, many Judeans took refuge in Egypt after the destruction of the kingdom of Judah. You can see in this map that Joseph and his family traveled across northern Egypt, called the Nile Delta. From there, they traveled south along the River Nile. According to legend, almost everywhere they stopped, a miracle occurred. Today, there are about 25 places maintained by the Coptic Christians to mark holy places where the family visited, which includes four monasteries in Wadi Natron, and in Cairo, there is a sycamore tree and chapel. The location of the sycamore tree marks a place where Mary rested. From the book of Matthew, Joseph was visited by an angel in his dream telling him, "Get up, take the child and his mother back to Israel, for those who were trying to kill the child are now dead." Joseph, Mary, and their child fled in 5 BC, and the following year, Herod died, and his son Archelaus ruled over Judea, which included Bethlehem. Joseph and Mary were afraid of Herod's son, so they chose to return to Nazareth. This fulfilled what the prophets had said: he will be called a Nazarene. When I travel, I have a smooth ride, air conditioning when it's hot outside, and heat when it's cold outside. I even have heated seats. Satellite radio is another modern convenience. I think we often forget just how inconvenient it was for people, especially with young children, to travel during the time of Jesus. Those kids couldn't watch any movies from the built-in video screen while riding on a donkey. I'm sure they were happy to find enough food and water during their travels. And now you know the rest of the story. Amen.
Thank you, Steve, for reading scripture, for challenging us, and giving us courage for life. One of the ways we respond to the gospel is in the giving of our gifts. They become a tangible sign of the giving of our lives. And so I am going to invite us to bring our gifts. You can either give by text, you can give online, or you can mail in. But before you think about that, let's pray together as we give ourselves and our gifts to God. Lord God, we thank you for Christmas and all that it means to us. Thank you for offering the gift of your Son. In response, we offer you our lives. And in offering our lives, we give these gifts as a sign of our love. So receive the gifts, receive our lives. Receive our city, receive our nation, receive our world, and continue to bless us that we might be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen. And so I'm going to invite the bells to play for us as you bring your gifts.